All right, let's now talk about transfer learning. In particular, we are going to take a look at how we can use a pre-trained VGG16 that has been pre-trained on ImageNet and then fine-tune it on a target dataset. We are going to work with Cypher 10. So in particular, we are going to freeze all the convolutional layers. We assume these are good feature extraction layers, and then we will only train the last fully connected layers. And in particular, we'll also replace the output layer, because in ImageNet, the output layer has 1,000 units, because in this particular case, it was fit to 1,000 classes. But yeah, Cypher 10 only has 10 classes, so we are also going to have to replace that one. All right, so let's take a look at the code example. So I actually made two notebooks. Let's take a look at this one first. So everything you can see here is the same as for the VGG16 I showed you before, so I don't have to discuss any of that in detail again here. It's the same things, except it's too large, maybe except for this line and this line here. So what are those? So those are again the means and standard deviations for standardizing the inputs. Why am I using these weird numbers and not 0.5 like before? So that is because that was used when they trained or pre-trained the model on ImageNet. So we are going to use a model from that Torch Vision library or repository that has been pre-trained on ImageNet, and they just happen to use these parameters. They derived them from the ImageNet dataset. I should say we are going to use the VGG16 here from this Torch Vision repository, and there are also other networks. We are just talking about VGG16 because it's familiar, but when you're working on the class projects, also really good networks. I mean, actually all of them are good, maybe except for AlexNet, it's a little bit dated. But yeah, DenseNet is a special version of ResNet that has each layer connected to each other layer. So it's like why it's called dense, it's fully connected in terms of the layers. Whereas with ResNet, we only have some of these residual connections. Mobile nets are really cool because they're very efficient and also give you very good performance. So I probably wouldn't use version 2 if there's already a version 3. ResNext is also like, I think it's a more mobile friendly version of residual networks. It's also, I think, a little bit faster. Wide ResNet can give you better performance if you have a large data set. Inception is also really good architecture. Google, you probably don't have to use GoogleNet because that's like an early version of Inception. But in any case, so there's a variety of things to use. All of them have been pre-trained on ImageNet. And here they say they derived this mean and standard deviation from ImageNet. And we are going to use the same values so that we make sure that our inputs are on the same scale as theirs in our Cypher 10 dataset. By the way, So sometimes it's also recommended to compute these really from scratch from your dataset. That's because it might be that all your images are systematically darker or systematically brighter or things like that, or less or more colorful. And to account for that, it might also be a good idea to derive these parameters from your own data set. So I have showed you this earlier in a previous video. I actually have done that and implemented that here, where we compute these from our data set for the Cypher 10 data set. But you can see they are essentially the same as for ImageNet, and I try to run the VGG16 with either those or the parameters that they propose on the website, and I didn't find any meaningful difference. So it's fine to use either or. In a practical application, if they are substantially different, you want to try out both, because there can be an argument made for either case. So you can say you should use these because that's what they used, and just to be consistent, but you can also say it makes more sense to use your own parameters because maybe your images have a systematic difference compared to the ImageNet images. All right, so that was just like a long version talking about standardization parameters. Moving on to the more interesting part, the transfer learning part. So we are now loading this pre-trained model. So actually you can load all the different models in a not pre-trained version, if that's useful to you, so you don't have to implement these from scratch. They are already available for you if you set pre-trained to false, it's essentially training them from scratch. So here we are talking about transfer learning. So we are using a pre-trained version, pre-trained on ImageNet. And this is how our VGG 16 looks like when we load it from the repository. So I'm calling model, which will just output the structure of the network. So you can see there's one part, it's called features here. And this part is really like the convolution layers, like because like we said earlier, the convolution layers can be understood as automatic feature extraction layers. So this would be the corresponding part. And then here, this would be our classification layer here. So where we have our sequential layer. All right, so this is how it looks like. So between there's adaptive average pooling, which is similar to global average pooling that we discussed in the previous videos. That is really just to make the bridge between the last layer in the convolutional part and the first layer in the linear part to make sure that we have this number of features when we have 7 times 7 times whatever the size is that comes out of here. All right, so we said we are only going to train the linear layers. So what we have to do is, so the easiest way I find that we can do that is by freezing the whole model first. So what we do is we iterate over all the parameters in the model like this, and then we set them to false, the requires gradient attribute, and this will essentially freeze the network. So you can still run forward and backward, but it will not update the parameters. They are now kind of fixed. All right, so this will freeze the model. And then we want to fine tune the last three layers. So if I go back to my visualization, so we are only going to fine tune this last part. So we have to kind of understand a little bit what this last part is. So we know, okay, this is in the classifier here, and there are different layers, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we have to pay attention to those that have parameters. So for instance, this linear one, dropout and Redu doesn't have parameters, linear, linear, and linear. These are the ones that we want to modify. So here I'm setting the one corresponding to 1 to true, and this one also to true. This is the one corresponding to 3. So I'm essentially saying these are now trainable again. So we want to train those, and we have to replace this one entirely because the output number of classes is 1000, but in Cypher 10 we only have 10. So here I'm providing my own linear layer. So I'm just using the same number of input features, 4096, but I'm just changing the number of output features to 10. And then it's training like usual. So I'm training it here, nothing new, it's exactly what we've done before. But what's interesting is now you can see it already starts with a pretty good accuracy. So if I compare it to our previous VGG 16, this is our own implementation, you can see it starts with 35, 50, 53. So here, this is already more powerful in that way. It's already kind of warmed up in a way, if you want, because it's pre-trained. And then it's training. But I found it doesn't give good performance here. So you can see it's only 77%. It's not great. So what's going on here? So the one explanation could be that ImageNet is much bigger. And they also say that here they expect the height and width to be at least 224. So usually networks are somewhat agnostic to the exact size if you use adaptive average pooling, like they have used here, because it will make sure that whatever is before here will have the output size of 77. So, and then it will make, then it, this will have the right dimension here, because this is guaranteed to be 7.7. But the problem is these layers before, they have assumed that the images have a certain size and the objects have a certain size. So they have been really trained maybe on larger images. So if the images are too small, the network performance might not be great. So what I did is I had a second implementation here where I just increased the size of the images to 224. I mean, it's not ideal because Cypher 10 is a very small data set and it will be very, very pixelated. But yeah, just for trying it out. So I was doing exactly the same thing except for the larger images. And you can see it has already better performance. It goes even up to I don't know, 84.9%. So in that way, yeah, this is actually a pretty good performance, given that this is a pre-trained network that we just fine-tuned a little bit. So we are only training the last three layers. Yeah, but also because the images are so large, it takes a long time now. All right, so what you can see also, let's take a look at the small one again. I was training it for 50 epochs, it took 38 minutes, and for the version that we trained from scratch, it was 90 minutes. So it's probably because, first of all, it's probably a little bit more efficient implementation, but it's mostly because we froze the convolutional layers, so we are only training the fully connected layers here. So that also saves a lot of time, 1 hour to be exact. So yeah, so this is how you can do transfer learning. But yeah, also, like I showed you before, how many layers to train, it really depends. So based on this paper, they found training three fully connected layers results in the best performance, but it really varies from case to case. Sometimes it might be better to only train the last layer. Sometimes it might be better to fine-tune all layers. It's really, yeah, depending on the particular case. But yeah, I hope this was useful. Now you know how to do transfer learning. And I think, yeah, this is also the last video for this lecture on convolutional networks. Next, we will start a completely new topic talking about recurrent neural networks working with text data.